While we began this session highlighting our strategy coherence, there's a common thread with our special talks. So this common thread for BIMTECH to structure the faculty development around was future road of management education. We commenced with future quality of assurance and accreditation in Indian higher education in September 2020, which further led to implications of NEP for higher education. And then on, we had our right now session on how technology will reshape the future of higher education. In our final week today, we are intrigued to listen to Dr. Anil Sachdeva on cultivating the culture of team building and shared leadership in these schools. Indian higher education has majorly suffered from centralization, lack of autonomy, poor team building, and almost absence of a collaborative and healthy work culture. We wait to hear from Dr. Sachdeva how can quality leadership in our universities and institutions be improved, and how a culture of collaborative teaching and research be developed by promoting team building as a necessary activity. I take the pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Anil Sachdeva. He is the founder and CEO of Grow Talent Company Limited and the School of Inspired Leadership, SOIL. Grow Talent was created in July 2000 and became the leader in strategic HR consulting industry by 2006. His experience in India and across the world covers areas such as talent management, strategic change, and organizational transformation. Recognized as a thought leader in leadership development and organizational transformation, Dr. Sachdeva has done pioneering work in leading global and local firms. He has spoken at national and global conferences all over the world and has written contributory pieces for leading publications. He has been adjunct faculty to leading B-schools such as ISB, Kelly School of Business, Indiana University, GMI, Flint, Michigan, Antioch University, Seattle, Ohio University, and the University of New Brunswick, Canada. He began his career with Tata Motors in 1975, with completing his MBA from University of Pune, and joined HR in 1978 and worked in HR operations in TQM. He is also the founder of HR Consultancy Services and was its CEO till 2001. He's active in management circle and has held several public offices such as chairman of National Committee of Leadership Development, Human Resources, Industrial Relations of Confederation of Indian Industry, CII. He is a member of the Academic Committee of CEDP, the leading leadership institute of Europe, located in Fontainebleau. He is a member of the World Compassion Council based in Seattle and a trustee of the Chinmaya Mission. He serves on the Global Board of Shizukan University in Tokyo. May I request you, Dr. Sachdeva, to commence the special lecture today?
I have a very practical question. You have had a wonderful session with Dr. Agarwal. Do you need a short break? Because if we go from one session... It's up to you. I am ready to go, but I'm just trying to put myself into your shoes. Do you need a few minutes to... get a cup of tea, use the facility? Would you like to do that?
We all are having tea.
So okay, wonderful. Wonderful. I was having my coffee and I was enjoying listening to Dr. Agarwal. So thanks to the few minutes of overlap, I was able to learn from what he was saying as well. So thank you for inviting me. First of all, you know, I've known Dr. Chaturvedi over the years, and I just very much admire his simplicity, his humility, and his always willingness to help. So for some of us who were practicing on the other side and, began to enter this field, and so we are still learning. Many of us are novices in the field of higher education. And I think we have been just doing some experiments and trying to learn from those experiments. So I think the established institutions such as yours, I think especially whenever one needs some guidance on how the country policy is going, what will the regulator say, what is going on. So many times we call Dr. Chaturvedi for his advice, and it's nice for him to be always very support about that. So, although I have specially prepared a number of PowerPoint slides for this session, but looking at the format, I think the PowerPoint I'll send you after our interaction, because this is only 45 minutes. And I noted my friend Sunil Sangra is here. When he used to work with the Trident, we had done a very large piece of work there, and he was one of the key leaders working with the founder of Trident. So I have known Sunil for a long time. He's also been adjunct faculty to SOIL. So nice to see you, Sunil, and nice to see all of you. So I'll send the PowerPoint later just so that you can have a look at it. There are five things I'm going to have a dialogue with you today about. And you can stop me at any time. You can raise your hand. You can say whatever, because we have limited time. So please, I want to honor your needs rather than my sharing just what I have in mind. But there are five points. First, you told me about culture for team building and shared leadership. So I want to talk about what is my experience of business school, because although I have been a practitioner for most part of my life, but I have been a very, say, curious practitioner. I've always spent time with the management institutes, and I've always enjoyed going and teaching the odd course in different parts of the world. So I have really, over the years, kept in touch. So I'm very interested in also what's happening to management education. And because I serve on some of these global boards of other schools, it gives me a chance to work in partnership with some of my peers, for example, from INSEAD or London Business School or Harvard Business School. And therefore, in conversation with that, I am, of course, aware of how some of the schools in those parts of the world are very introspective about business education and management education. So I want to make an attempt to just talk about what are they struggling with right now, including my friend Henry Mintzberg, who says MBA has completely failed. You know, University of McGill, you must have heard of Henry Mintzberg's work. He's a friend. And, you know, the whole aspect of how he says the MBA has been a complete failure, you know, that is his view, right? So I think there are lots of people who are struggling with and trying to say what's the relevance of management education. So that I just want to offer a few glimpses into that. The second part, you talk about building a culture. So all my life, I have been part of some fascinating organizations in co-creating culture. And I think we have learned a lot out of that. And we have helped some of the very large, complex organizations in also helping them to build their culture and working with them for a lengthy period of time. Companies like Tata Steel, for example, or the Mahindra Group, with whom we helped them create the whole culture initiative called RISE and worked with them for many years in that. So we have experience of helping others to build culture. And when it comes to business schools, I must say I don't have very good knowledge of how business schools work in India, because I've never worked in any one of them. As a visiting faculty, you don't get to understand the intricacies. But I have some observations about what could be happening in, and of course, our own experiment in SOIL, which is our own experiment in building culture. And the third attempt, what is this conversation on shared leadership that we are talking about? Because team building and shared leadership are just two sides of the same coin. And the fourth part is, what do you feel and what do I feel is the most important role for us today in this very difficult moment in humanity? What do you think you and I can do to take more responsibility? And that's the question of shared leadership and teamwork as well. And the very last question is, what can I personally do? Because, you know, we can all talk about team building and shared building leadership. What can I personally do? So these are the five dimensions. So let me offer some comments. First of all, I think that worldwide, there are two problems. You may have read, if you have not read that piece, I would very much urge you to read it. Warren Bennis, in 2005, published a very thought-provoking article on which way are MBA schools going worldwide. I would urge you to read it. It's a very, very beautifully written article. Yeah? Very thought-provoking. Here is what he said, which is where later my close friend Dr. Nitin Noria raised the same issue when he became Dean of Harvard Business School. He said, if management and business as a profession, do we really consider this as a profession? now a doctor, being a doctor is a profession, being a lawyer is a profession. But is business a profession? If so, do we have professional standards for business? Do we have a way to hold ourselves accountable? Do we in business school know how to hold our students accountable for the profession that we are preparing them? For example, if you are running a medical college and you have a hospital that you are attached to, you teach medicine and then you practice medicine. And so people can understand what's going on. Similarly, in law, all the top people who teach in good law schools are also partners of top law firms, or they are closely associated. Many of them are practicing law. So when they teach law, they are also practicing law. But in business schools, what happened, because the United States started this whole business school education movement, in the early part of the 20th century, most of the people who were teaching were just coming with their war stories. They were practitioners who were coming and sharing how they were, you know, doing. So it was all about, so unfortunately, business schools became more like what Warren Bennis calls trade schools. And they were not able to do any quality research. But then came the reverse, that everybody became very focused on research, so much so that the pendulum swung the other way around. And professors began to publish research which only was cited by peers, but the business world was ignoring that research because it was not adding much value to them. So you may have heard that 5 years back, the students of the MBA class in Wharton, they had a big agitation in Wharton Business School. They complained to the management that the professors were spending only time on research and they were not spending enough time on quality teaching. And therefore, they were being denied the quality teaching experience in the MBA class at Wharton. So one of the topmost business schools, there was a big agitation actually. And some of my friends who teach at Wharton were saying, you know, we had become so obsessed with just measuring our performance based on our research that we had forgotten our biggest customer is the MBA student who is in the campus, and we are not doing enough to get the best out of the learning experience for them. So I think somewhere between telling war stories and just getting practitioners to come and teach who are not adequately prepared because they are not thoughtful enough to go into the rigor that is required. So what we can call the science of teaching management, between that and the other approach, which is to say the world of business is a very complex subject. It is, there are many things which are interconnected. And unfortunately, business schools, like some companies, are divided into departments, and they even have in their, for example, when I used to go to Indiana University, one of my favorite universities where often I was also executive in residence, so I spent a lot of time there. My son also has an MBA from there. I used to find, here is my friend Dr. Ash Soni and his team in operations. They had a separate team and a separate almost part of the building. Marketing is another part. Finance is another part. The OB area is another part. So people are sitting in silos. They are meeting from time to time in this so-called interdepartmental meetings, which the MBA office is calling or the dean's office is calling. But hardly ever are they co-teaching anything together. Whereas in the world of business, you cannot define this as an HR problem or as a finance problem or as a marketing problem. There is a problem that we have to solve, or there is an opportunity to be taken advantage of. So I think the way business schools have unfortunately structured ourselves and the way we specialize and do research and work, and even though we all talk about collaboration and we all talk about joint research and we all talk about joint, you know, teaching, but the practical method is the problem is each one of us has our own workload. We have to teach so many hours. We have to write so many papers. We have to do so much of other work. And the occasional lunch experience that we have of sitting together, or these days having experience on Zoom. So I think the question we need to ask ourselves in business schools is, are we really preparing students for the real world in that sense, where, as Bennis said, or as Aristotle said many times, the whole purpose of education is to know who you are. really the meaning of the word educate is know who you are. It doesn't matter whether you study physics or you study engineering or you study philosophy. The whole purpose is to discover who are you and why are you here. Are we preparing students for leading a purposeful life? And are we preparing them to think with the whole mind? So this is a question that we need to ask ourselves. And, you know, therefore, how do we build character in our students? Do we have the assumption that character is built early in our schooling and education? And that business school, it is not our job to build character? I think this is something that we need to ask ourselves, that how are we responsible for the character of our students? Do we give them the importance of teaching them liberal arts? Do we say why philosophy, music, poetry, literature is as important as the study of finance and marketing? Do we even have space in our curriculum to explore those subjects? Do we teach them how to solve real social problems? Are our students taking responsibility for contributing to making the world better? And are we holding ourselves accountable for that? These are questions to be asked. What difference has our education made? A few years back, my dear friends in INSEAD who are associated with this Leadership Institute, where I've been part of their academic council for last 9 years, I teach there in Fontainebleau. Each time I go there, they were telling me, Anil, can you present with the, you know, the work you have done in soil? How are you looking at the learning outcomes of, let's say, the program that you have developed? And I told them about this research that we did and about the great difficulty with which we completed our research to study the impact our 100 alumni had made. This was after 5 years of soil. We were trying to understand what difference has our education made to these students and the impact they are having. And we were trying to find out, is it because of their family? Is it because of some other environment? Or is it because of what we did in the time they spent in soil? It's a very complex exercise. But I think we need to ask ourselves that question. So I'll just, this was my first part, opening comments, that we really need to, and I want to say something else to you. A teacher always teaches who she is, irrespective of what you teach. That means, what is the life that we as faculty are leading, and what is the story our life has? What impact does that have on our students? What do they learn from our lives? It doesn't matter what we teach. Because, you know, a teacher teaches more about the way she lives her life rather than what she speaks in the class. And so if we are teaching good management and good business, how many of our faculty members are conveying that from the way we lead our own lives? And that's a very important question for all of us to ask ourselves. Now coming to the second dimension, which is of culture. I think culture is really about the way you do things, right? It's the way you play the game of business education. And it's the way you actually act. You may write a vision statement, you may write even a purpose statement, but how do we, is our culture, is our vision, is our purpose, are the values that we are stating, is that a doing framework? Does that define the way we govern ourselves? Do every one of the things we do are actually living that culture every day? Let me give an example. In many of our organizations, we talk about collaboration, but when you go and study the way decision making happens, very often they are top driven decision making forums. There is very little co-creation and involvement and genuine participation, and yet that company talks about collaboration as a core value. So the question is, how do we live this every day? It has to be a doing framework, not just a nice statement that we all are inspired by. So what do we do every day? Therefore, there are four dimensions on the doing framework. First of all, when people sit together and informally share stories. So today I spent some time on your website and I saw this wonderful story of Dr. Chaturvedi that, you know, many years back you wrote that, you know, you were looking at in new location, and then the Greater Noida Authority advertised for the land And then you applied, then you went for the interview, then you got the land. And then there was this difficult decision that you should you move there, because a lot of people felt that it's not, the conditions are not ready there. And yet after some time you chose to move there, right? That's a story that you narrate as to how initially it was very difficult, and then you had this colleague, this Brigadier Saab from the army, who created the kind of atmosphere for BIMTEC to grow in the new location. So there is a story in your website, right? It told me something about the kind of culture that there was. Dr. Chaturvedi and all of you said, we are not going to allow these hurdles. We will take responsibility of actually creating something. So there is something about your culture that was revealed through that story. What are the stories people say to each other when they sit over cafeteria? When a new person comes, what are the stories that person hears from all of you? Because every organization is nothing but a set of stories. What are the stories, BIMTEC? What are the stories that your students talk about BIMTEC? What are your alumni talking about? What stories they narrate? What stories they narrate that whole thing? What kind of recruiter experience do you have? People who are the industry people who have visited you, what experience did they have with you? What are your peers from other schools who have visited you or interacted with you? What story do they narrate about BIMTEC? So the first part is, it's all a set of stories and experiences. That is how your culture is built. So if you're trying to build a culture of shared leadership and teamwork, to what extent are the stories of in campus that are being talked about by all your stakeholders resonate with that theme? Second, what are the rituals you practice to live that culture? For example, in SOIL, we have a ritual of a morning circle every day. If you see, every morning at 8:50 a.m., all our students and faculty, we are in a morning circle. These days it is on Zoom. Otherwise, in both our campuses, it is done through physical spaces, right? So pre-COVID, we used to all hold hands. And then one of the students or a staff member, whoever feels like, will recite a prayer from any denomination. It could be a Christian prayer, Hindu prayer, Buddhist prayer, it doesn't matter what prayer. And everybody, we pray together in the morning for a few minutes, right? Then we have a ritual of celebrating landmarks. If a faculty member has finished 2 years there, then everybody will say something about what did they notice about the faculty member. That is shared as in a ritual of appreciation. What are the rituals we observe for handling failures? For example, we were targeting to launch a new program this year on complete postgraduate program in digital transformation, and we launched the marketing, but we were unable to get enough applicants for that school, so we decided to make it just a area of specialization rather than a regular program. So we were unable to get that attraction in the digital environment. And so what is the ritual we follow to say, why did we fail and how are we going to learn out of that failure? What is the ritual we have for celebrating each other's success? What is the ritual we have for any particular milestone or important aspect? So I think the rituals that we observe have a very profound impact on our culture. Number three, in the way we build spaces, what do the artifacts and the architecture and design of spaces, how do they reflect our culture? If we are talking about, for example, shared leadership and collective kind of culture, do we have spaces like that? If we talk about collaboration, for example, in SOIL, when we designed our campus, we said we must have the teacher as a facilitator. In 2008, we wrote, our faculty will not be the sage on the stage. That's a term we borrowed from one of our American professor friends. Person will not be a sage on the stage, but he would be a facilitator for learning. So we said we must convert our classrooms into learning studios. And there was opposition. My son was telling me, no, you must have the typical Harvard classroom. I said, we don't want the Harvard classroom design in SOIL. We will have learning studios. So we decided to have round tables in the classroom. And we said this will have a profound impact on for us, for the teacher to say, I am a facilitator and I am not speaking at my students. The focus is not on me. The focus is on the community of learners with the facilitator. So as an example, what kind of culture, if you are trying to build, how do the artifacts, spaces, learning spaces your conference room that you have for the faculty. One day we decided it used to be called the board room. Then we came out with an idea it should actually be called a dialogue room. We should not be calling this a board room. And he said, anybody can book that. It doesn't matter who the person is. If the junior most faculty member or a staff member is calling a meeting and has booked that space, then even if I as the founder want that space, I cannot take it. This is the power of collective that we want to express ourselves. So we must follow that. So those are the artifacts. The last part is, and Warren Bennis also refers to it in his 2005 paper, very thought-provoking paper. You cannot practice anything which is of building a great organization unless you decide how are you looking at the outcomes of what you are doing. And outcomes cannot always be measured. If you go back into the theory, and unfortunately business school professors began to copy too much from scientific disciplines like physics or engineering, where they wanted to measure everything. Actually, in business, the biggest aspects cannot be measured. For example, even though you may do a culture survey and ask people to look at satisfaction with culture, it can't really be measured. That glue is something intangible. For example, the quality of judgment that you make, you cannot judge that except in hindsight, say this decision was good or not good. You may have decision quality, but you can't really measure the intangibles of things like judgment or things like character or things like glue or things like inspiration. The most wonderful things about business decision, the most difficult decision you take, cannot be measured. And unfortunately, we have tried to become too scientific in wanting to measure everything. And a lot of us have done mistake by saying, if you cannot measure it, you cannot improve it. I think it's a dangerous statement, because you may not be able to measure it in that sense like you can do a scientific subject. In business, there are a lot of qualitative aspects that you have to go by a collective experience. My next point I want to offer to you is that if you want to build shared leadership in your institute and the whole aspect of teamwork, the question that you have to ask yourself is, what can we do to take individual responsibility for serving the whole? And I will suggest a very simple thing. You see, I have a very close friend called Dr. Paul Tuchinsky. Paul was originally at Case Western Reserve University, and he was the man who helped us with what we call the large-scale transformation program that we did with organizations like Larsen & Toubro and about 100 other organizations. This was the whole systems thinking is a discipline that emerged there at that time. And they discovered almost by accident the power of this new subject, which is now being called for last 30 years, positive psychology. There were his young research associate called David Cooper Ryder was working with him at that time. And I don't have time to give the whole story, but there was another wonderful eminent Indian colleague there called Suresh Srivastava. These people discovered the power of transformation based on what is present, rather than try to worry about solving a problem based on what is absent. I think this whole way of thinking, and in all the organizations I have been part of, including Eicher Consultancy, Grow Talent, and now Soil, we have an annual ritual for the last 30 years in whichever organization I have been part of. We call it the annual ritual of appreciative inquiry and rejoicing. We call it FAIR, Festival of Appreciative Inquiry and Rejoicing. What we do, we encourage each other to interview each other. So I will ask Dr. Anupam Verma will be interviewing Dr. Muhammad Akbar, and Anupam ji will ask Muhammad ji, tell me, Muhammad Akbar ji, when were you and your team at your best this year? What enabled you to do your best work? When were you at your happiest best this year? Who were the people involved? And we encourage you to listen to each other with that childlike curiosity. Who were the people involved? What did they do? What was special about that experience? And they capture stories from each other. and identify the strengths of the organization based on those stories. And then there is a meeting of all the staff and faculty in Eicher Consultancy, all our consultants. We also used to call our clients to those meetings. So also in Grow Talent, we ask to share the stories with each other. So now Dr. Sahai has interviewed Dr. Ghosh, and he's narrating the story about Ghosh Babu as to how Ghosh Babu has done amazing work this year. And Ghosh Babu is saying how Dr. Sahai has done. So they share these stories, and then we collectively take responsibility. So what were the positives inside our own organization that helped us to do our best work this year? Then we collectively mine the strengths. And then we say, so this we call every year a discovery process. And we are going to do this shortly in the month of July in SOIL. The second part is, if we have to leverage our strengths, how do we build our school for the next wave of transformation? How do we take responsibility for leveraging that? What are our dreams? So every employee is creative and imaginative and says, how can we build a powerful picture of the future where we can do some wonderful work? So everybody's ideas are put together and we do collective dreaming. And out of that, we say, what are the things we will do this year to take responsibility for making our dreams come true? So that is the field of design, intentional design. And then we end with saying, what will each one of us do to take responsibility? What will teams do? What will individuals do? That then feeds into our regular cycle. So we have our business planning process, which takes place. And then we have this creative imagination-based, positive psychology-based process that takes place to build shared leadership and the power of collective teamwork. So the four D's: discover, dream, design, and deliver. And we have used this a lot. Sunil will remember the entire Trident transformation program that we ran was based on this whole 4D process. It was called Anand Ka Abhishek. And someday when we have time, we can go. We have also extensively published papers on this. For those of you who want to do research papers, we have published this also extensively on this field. So you can read the stories about how that has been done. But this thing that we do in SOIL each year is a wonderful way of breaking silos. It's a wonderful way for everybody to come together, enjoy together, celebrate together, and also take responsibility. And of course, we set aside time, say, this is what we had planned to do last year. What did we actually end up doing? What can we learn out of that? That also is a process of learning. So this way of the collective work involvement is such an extraordinary gift we give to ourselves. That's why we call it the festival of appreciative inquiry and rejoicing. Last, you know, why do we not do great things together? Or why do we not, for example, BIMTech could dream about becoming the very best in the world. And in some respects, we want to do that. But what prevents each one of us of aspiring to be the best version of ourselves? I think this comes because we are not on an inner journey of reflection, each one of us. And therefore, I want to connect it to the fourth dimension to say, this collective teamwork and shared leadership that we talk about is important for us to take responsibility individually. And here I connect it to our Indian wisdom traditions. You know, there are five aspects of all of us. One, how I lead my own physical self and physical well-being, because everything requires stamina. For example, you know, a few weeks back I got COVID, and I had something called long COVID. So I was on steroids and everything else. And ultimately I had to learn how to take responsibility for my own healing, because what I eat, the way I eat, what I drink, what self-knowledge I have of what's happening to my body is something I must take responsibility for my physical well-being. So how do I take responsibility for my own physical well-being? Because I have to make sure that I am with my students, my faculty, as my Japanese friend, Dr. Noda, who was at Harvard, who has set up Shizuoka University, told me, Anil-san, you cannot leave us for another 10 years. So you have to promise, do not allow the COVID to take you away. I said, Tomo-san, thank you very much. I love your enthusiasm. And I'm going to take responsibility for making sure that I'll do my best. Then next, you leave it to the rest. The second part, how do I lead my own communication well-being? How do I listen by putting myself into other people's context? How do I listen with empathy? And how do I, and with every breath, take responsibility for my own response to situations I face? That's the way I observe my breath, because, you know, the prana, I do not know if you believe in the wisdom tradition, but many of us say we carry with prana also some prarabdha, as the Sanskrit word is. We carry tendencies even from our past lives. So it's the old discussion between destiny and free will. So how do you practice free will, which is called purushartha, and how do you take responsibility for your prarabdha, which is make your destiny happen rather than just leave it to destiny, right? So communication well-being. Third, how do you lead your emotional well-being? Because a lot of us get disturbance. I mean, so many of us have lost near and dear ones in the recent time, right? How do I handle grief? How do I be of support to others? How do I do small acts of kindness every day for others? And how do I express gratitude for the life that I have been given? Emotional well-being. Then intellectual well-being. How do I take the zest for learning? How do I retain that childlike curiosity? It doesn't matter whether I'm 80 or I'm 70. Dr. Chaturvedi was telling me some of your wonderful professors are physical age is high, but you are amazing people because you continue to have that love for learning. So how do you do that? And how do you let the fears go into the background so that you can be more creative? Our fears prevent us from being creative. So how do you take responsibility for empowering your fears with the power of love? You know, our spiritual teacher Swami Chinmayananda also always used to tell us, they said, listen, he told us, fear has to be overcome with the power of love. And in order to narrate the power of that, I am going to talk about, therefore, the last point which I talked about, which is the power of higher purpose. You see, each one of us must ask ourselves the question, what am I in this world to do? How can I take responsibility? Because the moment from intellectual well-being I ask that question, then I overcome my own ego. And that's when I become ready, where I become the instrument for the larger purpose. And when I'm able to transcend my ego, I discover that higher power within me, which is what, as somebody said in the chat box, the power of the panchakoshas. So I finally reach my spiritual well-being because I derive the power from my core values and character that comes out of the space of pure sight. Ananda bhaya meri maya satguru mein paya, which means when we lead a life of greater purpose, then the ego shuts up, then individual difficulties with each other disappear, and we get inspired by higher purpose. And therefore, I want to end with a life-changing experience that I had. You see, we were working with the board of Taj Group of Hotels. We were helping them with succession planning to help them to select their next MD and so on. And 26th of November, the terrorists entered the Taj. So Raymond Bixon and I, the MD, were exchanging notes, and he said, Anil, please pray for us. Then I came to know the Unilever team is also there, the global team. So I was exchanging SMS messages with Nitin Paranspe, who was the chairman here, and Lina Nair, the head of HR. They also said, pray for us. So all night I was sending messages. I may have even written to Dr. Chaturvedi, I don't know, but I was sending messages all over to all friends to pray for people in Mumbai and the Taj. Early morning, I took a flight and went to Mumbai, and I joined the management team of Taj at the President Hotel, because the people who were inside the Taj were there, but there were other management team members, including their head of HR, HN Srinivas. We were all part of that team to say, how can we take, what can we do to serve the city? And, you know, I called Anjali Raina, my dear friend who heads the Harvard Business School office in India. She lives next to the Taj president. So she came and joined us. Later on, she and Rohit Deshpande wrote that case study on Taj based on what she witnessed that day. So a few hours later, the HN Srinivas told me, Anil, there is very bad news. Karambir Kang, the general manager, he's lost his wife and children. And the news will be on TV in some time. But before we break it to TV, we want you to tell your sister who lives in Chandigarh, whose husband is a retired brigadier, to go and call on General Kang. His father's house, who's living there.
I believe there's a brief lag in the network at Dr. Sachdev's end, so please bear with us.
Sorry about that, because there was a power failure. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, absolutely. You're audible, sir.
Are you able?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, there was a power failure for a minute. I went off the line, but I'm back now.
Yes.
So there was silence as we were sitting with Karambir's parents and with Karambir. Then Karambir's mother turned to me and said, Anjali, may I share what happened earlier? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, Karambir called me when the terrorists were in the lobby of the hotel. And he said, ma'am, a part of me wants to go and run after my wife and children in the old wing of the Taj. But I am the son of a soldier. How can I leave my colleagues in the lobby? How can I go and look after my own family when I am with them? I hope Vaheguruji will forgive me, ma, for making this choice. And she said, you know, I didn't know what to say, because here is somebody, I had heard about people doing the supreme sacrifice in the war, because my whole family is from, you know, the army and services, but I'd never heard about such a thing happening right in front of eyes in a business organization. And when we came back from that guest house and came back to President Hotel that evening, we met all the guests who had been evacuated from Taj, brought to President. They told us stories about Thomas Varghese. This man, he and his staff members formed a human chain around guests, allowed all of them to escape. And then Thomas asked all his staff to escape. But when he was the last man trying to go out, he was shot dead. So next day, Mr. Krishna Kumar, the vice chairman of Taj, and Mr. Ratan Tata met Mrs. Varghese and said, Mrs. Varghese, we didn't know that Thomas was such a courageous person. So she said, sir, even I didn't know that he was a courageous person. All I know is that he loved the Taj and he loved the people there. So that night before I went to sleep, my teacher Swami Chinmayananda's voice was reading to me, saying, when you rise in love, many wonderful things happen to you. You get the capacity to overcome all your limitations and fears. He says, when you rise in love. So if you have the kind of organization that the Taj Group had built, with whom we had the privilege of working for many years, that special glue, that there is a larger purpose we are in this organization for, that this is our workplace. And if we can have that kind of a spirit in every organization, in all our business schools to say, and I'm sure you have a sense of belonging and pride in BIMTech, but if you can carry that with that sense, this is our school, we are doing something special, and we are making a big difference, then you rise in love. And when that happens individually, you come to work every day, not just because you have some job to do, but work becomes pure inspiration. It becomes, you know, like in the words of Khalil Gibran, work is love made visible. Work is love made visible. So that's what I just wanted to end by saying, the real power of shared leadership and teamwork is when we have that higher purpose that resonates deeply in our heart, that we consciously try to help each other to rise in love, and we work as a team where we are really looking at that whole aspect of to respond to your questions and comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sachdev. And though I have a tentative script or there too, but I just want to say that I'm at loss of words after hearing. And it's such an out of the world experience, actually, to just realize the purpose behind all that we are doing here. So while may I invite a few brief questions from the faculty colleagues here.
Anilji, if I may, wonderful to see you again. And always very inspiring to be in your presence, right? I think you've brought out all the issues so clearly, so vividly, and with such conviction, right? So I don't have any questions. I will leave that to my colleagues, but just wanted to thank you for being here.
Thank you, Sunil. Thank you very much. And as you all know that, you know, we are all co-creators and fellow travelers. So thank you for co-creating this, and thank you for sourcing the inspiration for the from, you know, I made an instrument. So thank you.
Your last word, work is love. It's really very inspiring. I don't have a question, but you said work is love made visible. I mean, many of us really love our work, but we don't make it visible. So how do you really, what do you recommend to make your work visible?
I would say just take the time to create time and space amongst yourselves to have a conversation about what has deep meaning for you and how can you help each other to develop that sense of what each one of you is attempting to do and how that is connected. You see what happens, Dr. Sahay, very often years pass by without our knowing how we are internally changing, you know. Each one of us change over time, and many of us have personal contexts that we sometimes do not discuss with other colleagues. It's so important for us to understand each other's context, understand what is important to each one of us, how we are growing and developing, what's happening in our context. Just taking the time and space to listen to each other in that sense will build a different connection. And hopefully it will inspire each other to say, how can I support your growth, you know. So, you know, so Isha may say one day that, you know, this year I want to spend more time on research, and can somebody please help me to enable this to happen. And someone else may say, this year I want to really do some special work with an organization, and can we do something creative together, because that's how it's connected to how I am looking at my purpose. When you give each other permission to say what's important to you, how is that connected to what is special, what has meaning for you, I think we create the time and space for us to encourage each other, and that helps us to develop a special relationship with each other. Yeah. So I'm sure you already love working together. I think BIMTech is a great organization, if you consciously invest time in having some dialogue of this kind, maybe this will support everything else that you are doing.
Dr. Sachdeva, just one little point. Rituals of success are easy, you know. You can celebrate your success with your friends, with your peers, with everybody. You mentioned about rituals of failure. Now, I want you to just explain very briefly what did you actually mean by rituals of failure. Yes, we all fail, you see. And we learn from our failures. But then how do we actually propagate that failures amongst our peers and, you know, our friends? How do we go about it?
So, you know, there are two aspects to it. I will give the analogy. Just like when we lose some near and dear one, for example, during COVID times, then the first thing we do is we come together and we mourn together. And we express about the departed soul, and we have a prayer meeting. These days we are holding prayer meetings on Zoom. So there is a collective mourning that follows a loss. After that, people come forward to support. You know, in our Indian culture, the neighbors will cook because you will not be cooking in your house, and the entire community comes together to support the person who has had this grief. And then gradually the person comes slowly in terms with leading the life without the person who the family has lost. In an organization, similarly, if we were to learn from this ritual in the Indian culture, if when there is an organizational failure, a project has failed, a new program has failed, some effort that we wanted to do has failed, I think we need to create time and space for the team to come together and discuss that negative emotion and let people express what they are feeling. It's like mourning the loss of somebody. We should give each other the permission for that emotion to be expressed. And when that happens and people are able to express how bad they are feeling or etc., etc., then the next conversation can begin to say, what did we learn from the failure? No? And I think in that, you know, the old way used to be, and that used to shut up because that used to be the very, I would say, destructive ritual. People would start asking who is responsible for the failure. The moment you ask who, then everybody wants to save their own skin, right? So instead of doing that, if the conversation is about what happened, what was the experience, what can we do to learn from that and to take corrective action. So that's why, you know, in the Silicon Valley, where we used to have an office when I was in Aisha Consultancy, we were 50% owned by a company called Strategic Decisions Group. These are all faculty from Stanford Business School. So 180 PhDs all from Stanford. And Dr. Bruce Judd from Stanford, we moved him to Mumbai, took a suite for him in Oberoi Hotel and created our strategy practice. So he worked with us for 3 years in India. What I learned from all my friends in Stanford, that, you know, you must deal with failure as a badge of honor. That means people, for example, in SDG, the partners who failed on significant pitches on business development or on projects with large companies, we used to have a ritual at partners meeting of that person sharing the whole story. And everybody used to applaud the person for expressing what went wrong and what can we learn from it. This is a great culture in the Silicon Valley. They say failure is a badge of honor. So we had this office in Sandhill Road and I was there every 3 months and I was quite amazed. And I said, this is something really worthwhile to learn from the spirit of innovation in the Silicon Valley. As some of them were all associated with the Stanford Design School as well. So it was very interesting that was the first time I personally got exposed, and in my eyes quite got opened up. Then one day they introduced me to their client 3M. And 3M actually used to have this forum in which people used to share failures, and they were actually given rewards, like recognition for sharing failures. And no wonder 3M went on to become one of the most innovative companies. So I think the good news is that some of the organizations in India And Sunil also, I know, has a lot of interest in design thinking. I think people who are taking a design mindset are actually looking at failure as an opportunity to make a new product happen. And so it's such an important part of the whole process. The good news is that we can definitely do it. Of course, the not so good news is that, yes, for many years we have looked at it as a stigma. So we will have to change the language. And therefore, we will have to create a new language to look at that. And not do lip service, but genuinely invest in people. So that's what it is. It's like my son, when he came back from his MBA, he wanted to set up his own venture. So very quickly he created a company, hired many people, opened many. He was running the pizza restaurants called Flip Bistro. So one after the other, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and venture capital wanted to invest. And he said, no, the valuation is not right. So all that happened. Then after some time, the business turned the other way and he began to lose a lot of cash. Then I told him, Sahil, now what do you want to do? He said, well, I think I need to now realize that this is something that perhaps I don't have the capacity to organize more cash. I said, very good. I said, what would you like to do? I want to do something new. I said, would you like to come and help us build our second campus? First, he was very reluctant to work with his father and, you know, do things like that. but then he said, why not? And I said, you know, we will create a separate structure. So you don't, you know, you will get independence. So interesting. I said, you know, so my board members said to me, Sahil is more valuable now because he has experience how to build something, experience success and also fail. So hopefully that learning would be very useful as he builds a new school of design and so on, you know, school of business design. So I told my son, I said, don't take it to heart. You know, you lost a few crores, but that's okay. You know, it's 7-8 crores of money loss is fine. But what you have to say to yourself, you have invested in a great education. On when you now go to a classroom and talk about design and learning from failure, you have a first-hand experience to share. So it's something very interesting. So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you. Sir, can I say a few things?
Anji Sanjeev ji.
So I just wanted to share with my colleagues that my introduction to Dr. Anil Sachdev happened 26 years ago when I went for a job in Eicher Consultancy Services. And he said, well, you know IT, but we are not into IT consulting. But your problem is that you wanted to be consultant, but you are too old to join the consulting firms. And this was something which I learned from him to understand, or maybe in that conversation, that I need to realize if I really want to be a consultant, I need to find a firm where IT consulting is the main
exactly. business.
And that's how I landed up in IBM, and then we remained in touch.
You did amazing work in IBM, Sanjeev. I remember, and then all the work, I think you also did that major thing with Tata Steel, right?
Right, sir.
Yeah.
Wonderful,
you did amazing work. You did amazing work, and thank God you leverage your strengths. Actually, that's right.
Thank you, sir.
Same thing happened to Debashish Chatterjee when he was in IIM Calcutta. He applied for a job with Eicher Consultancy, and I told him, Debashish, you are a very good researcher. By hiring you as a management consultant, I would be denying the field of management education good talent. So I think you don't come and do this. I mean, we can get consultants from anywhere, but you are aware, you have an original mind. So continue to work with Professor S.K. Chakrabarty. And I'm glad Debashish did that. He's an outstanding researcher and educator today. But at one time he was very keen to join us. So that's another story. Yeah.
So may I ask you one question that's slightly different?
Abhijit, boliye.
So why don't the institution builders in India do not get the kind of recognition they should be getting? They do fabulous things, and yet they do not get the kind of recognition they should be getting, even in the field of management education also.
Well, I'm not sure, but your question is thought provoking, I think. But you know, when I was a young man growing up and I heard about IIM Ahmedabad, I used to hear about Ravi Mathai. the man who helped in building IIM Ahmedabad. So he was not there for very long, but till today, I mean, the fact that you nodded your head, you would have heard his name, right? So there is something special. But you are right. If you ask how many such people can we name as institution builders, even in field of management education, the names are very few. The reason, I suspect, is something to do with the nature of governance, because many of the so-called well-known business schools have been for too long controlled by the government bodies and, you know, too much of regulation. And I think that they have therefore looked at their job in a different context. I don't think they ever felt that this is my institute and I own it. I think Debashish has to some extent attempted that in IIM Kozhikode, and then, you know, and he also could not get the term he wanted as a director and went to IMI and then now has come back. Yeah, there aren't that many. I think to that extent, Dr. Chaturvedi, who has been for a long time in BIMTech, can take some loving pride that he can say, I am truly contributing to institution building.
Absolutely.
Because he has stayed here for a long time, and he can, and I think the institute and he are sort of very well closely associated.
Right.
But
right.
Not that many people, you are right. And I don't have the answer to this, except to say that even in this, if we change the conversation, not this morning I had a Zoom call with Dr. Devi Shetty for Narayana Hridayalaya, right? So we are doing some work with their leadership team. And Dr. Shetty and I was talking. He was saying, Anil, to build the healthcare system of the country, this is what I think we need to do. And all his talk was building the healthcare system in the country. He not once talked about what is in it for Narayana Hridayalaya, right? So his whole vision and the way he lives his life and the way he commits himself every day is to build something much greater. So I think it requires that genuine love for doing something bigger than yourself.
Absolutely.
So I think the answer lies in all of us saying, how do I actually contribute to something much bigger? Because Abhijitji, you are aware that none of us are the doers. I know that nobody follows me. The people who work with me don't follow me at all. They only work with me because they are inspired by a common cause. So that's what I tell my students. If you are inspired by higher purpose, leadership will happen to you. Therefore, the best leaders are the world's best followers. If you follow that cause of institution building, others will go along with you.
Right.
But if it's about yourself, then the focus is something else. Yes.
So as a leader, you think that the creating common cause or so-called shared value is the most important thing?
It is the most crucial, and you becoming the first servant of that. That's why to my students, I often say, I am the chief servant of soil. I said, okay, my title may be chairman and founder or whatever it is. I mean, those are for governance purposes and legal reasons. But otherwise, I want to call myself the chief servant of the school, because I think that's what it really is, right?
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
I think, sir, if I continue your answer just in 30 seconds, I think I love this because I connect it immediately with what I.G. Patel did, a great economist from India. He was invited by London School of Economics for the dean position. And you will remember that he was given the letter that you are invited for an interaction. And when the secretary came to the hotel to ask him to appear before the interview board, he denied because the letter did not say you have to appear in the board. So I think that kind of academic credibility and academic dignity and academic, if in the soft term I can say academic ego, the positive ego, right? The way you said positive leadership, positive appreciative. So that also is one of the great contributors in shaping a leader, and those kind of leaders can shape the next generation.
That's right. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well said.
I see you
unmuted. You quoted Ravi Mathai.
Yes.
To me, it appears leadership happened to him. And he, after establishing, he quit it. He said, I don't want to be director. What I had to give, I have given. Now I will be a faculty here. Let somebody else take it to New York.
Absolutely.
So he was really ready to quit. IIM was much greater than him. And that's how, I mean, there have been better professors than him. But as a leader, he is known, he will ever be remembered. Because of that thinking, that thought.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you.
Anilji, if I may, just a quick question, please. Which yes. is, you know, I remember you were talking about integrating liberal arts into the curriculum of the MBA program you have at the School of Business Design.
Yes.
Could you share any thoughts on how you went about doing it? How has the experience been?
Yes. So, you know, we have these courses on anthropology, sociology and psychology that we are teaching. And we have taken professors who are not taught in business schools at all. For example, we have a team of anthropologists, social anthropologists, Dr. Kailash Chandra Malhotra, who was associated, he was the leader with the Iravati Karve behind the Western Ghats movement, worked for 40 years at the grassroots level on doing social anthropology and research, and one of the most outstanding minds in the country. He and his team of dedicated professors, they custom designed the whole experience, and they also then connected it to ethnography and, you know, anthropology that is relevant for us in the field of business. And similarly, the psychology courses were designed by my colleague Dr. Priya Somaiya, who also worked with me for many years, who was a practicing psychologist, and she had done a lot of work on organizational transformation. And she connected it to there. So the people that we brought were very unusual people, carefully chosen. And they brought this interdisciplinary kind of flavor, and we gave them the autonomy and freedom to suggest how would they, once they understood our old philosophy. And something else we do, Sunil, we have something called Experiential Fridays for students. Here we introduce them to all kinds of interesting things, including, you know, aesthetic design, art, literature, poetry, lessons from the epics. So we have very unusual programs on these Experiential Fridays, including, you know, people getting their hands dirty, working with clay work and models and all kinds of very interesting things that happen to really source their whole mind. There is no grading, there is no system, it's just creating a very interesting experience of that kind. And the whole conversation is about, and then of course we have these Wednesdays after they have spent some time in the school, then the student teams on Wednesdays go and do work with NGOs on social innovation, right? So we had this very interesting things that about 20 Wednesdays on social innovation and about 40 Fridays on experiential Fridays. So some 60 days in a year, which is a large amount of time, right? In a 2-year MBA program, so total of that kind of time invested in doing something which is developing the being of the students. And so that, you know, that whole aspect of sourcing being. And then design, and we have 300 hours of design thinking. And there the whole thing about knowing this alternate models of thinking. And a lot of practice in practical projects as well. So knowing, doing and being, that whole combination that we have designed the curriculum. And it's early days yet. Of course, we have fortunately that 11 years of experience of running a 1-year program in the other campus. That has given us the right to experiment, because the whole soil was a completely new experiment in higher education. You know, we actually questioned it from scratch and said, how do we completely change the selection system for admitting students? How do we look at multiple intelligences? How do we look at talent appreciation process for students? So right from that stage, and then curriculum design with the help of a consortium company. So for example, for the new campus, when we did curriculum design, it was a seven day intense program. Using design thinking as an approach, and many of our consortium members came. So for example, Ajay Soni, the chief learning officer of Aditya Birla Group, spent 7 full days with us in that program, in being part of our curriculum design, because Ajay was learning how to use design thinking, which he went back and taught to then all his learning people in Aditya Birla Group. So it's very interesting, because you are associated with Aditya Birla, and you know BIMTECH has several governing board members from Aditya Birla. So very deep involvement of that kind. So when we get our industry involved, they actually come and they co-create things with us and ask new questions. So those kinds of things we do, right?
Evokes another question. Knowing and doing. Knowing, doing seems to me easier to be, practiced in a business school. But how you take your students to being level?
Yeah. So first of all, I personally teach a 30-hour course on what is called self-leadership, which incidentally I also teach in Europe and in Japan. It's all about, and it's based on our Indian spiritual heritage and all about that inquiry, who am I and why am I here, and going deeper. And the Panchakoshas is the starting point, right? And the Patanjali Yoga Sutras are going deeper into that. And then we take them for a week to the Chinmaya Ashram in Sidbadi in the Himalayas. There the students live together in the ashram. They also visit the work of the Chinmaya Organization of Rural Development. And it's a very interesting practice that we have there. Students go and work in villages, they spend time, they come back, and then they enact their learning through multiple intelligences. So they design skits, dance, and musical performance to depict their learning. And the representatives of Chinmaya Organization of Rural Development come and witness that. And students later on describe that as the most unforgettable week of their lives. You know? Then we have this wonderful teacher called Susie Roy, who was raised in South Africa, then went to America, and she's a yoga teacher. She teaches a course on mindfulness and yoga and meditation practice. And she uses a text called Chup Sadhana. Chup Sadhana is a book written by an Islamic scholar called Manzoor, who has studied the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads. So it's very interesting. So we have that whole core course in what we call mindfulness practice. So we have a curriculum around being, which is design. So it's actually the experience and curriculum around being. This is something very close to our heart, because the knowing and doing other schools also spend a lot of time on. But we right from the beginning identified that this is going to be a special aspect for us. And we have invested in that. And we feel very good that we have done that. And the practice of compassion, which also is the next part, which is that whole social innovation program where our student teams work with NGOs every Wednesday. That also makes them humble. That makes them, many times students have never worked in those contexts, you know, like they are now doing. So, and of course, these days it is being done digitally, but anyway, so well, that's what it is. Thank you.
Any more questions, or I don't see any hands raised here with me. Thank you, Dr. Sachdev.
Thank you very much. You know, and you may make me an honor by calling me doctor. I'm not a PhD or a doctor, although I've had the privilege of learning from many PhDs. Just call me Anil. I know in different parts of the world also people keep calling me doctor. I said, no, that's something I don't have the privilege of getting a doctoral program.
Okay.
But I have enjoyed working with my colleagues who do research and who learn from that. Yeah, thank you.
So a very heartfelt confession, and this special lecture session has been more of an introspection rather than a monologue. And this session has been of gratitude and appreciation, as I see it, of collective dreams and rituals and roundtables, and the idea of a dialogue is what we all are going to carry from. It is so much in line with our vision, you know. So WIMTEC's vision is to develop ethical leaders with entrepreneurial and global mindset, and we strive for sustainability and inclusive growth. But perhaps this lecture session tells us how do we actually achieve it. So that's a way forward for us. So I take this opportunity to express my gratitude on behalf of the Institute, and thank you for your insights. And I'm sure it will help us as a fraternity to inculcate collaborative teaching and promote teamwork.
Thank you.